Hi everyone, and welcome to our talk on investigating publisher applications of corpus research on recent language change to ELT course book development. My name is Niall Curry, and I'm a lecturer and Aspire Research Fellow at Coventry University.
And I'm Robbie Love. I'm a lecturer in English language at Aston University in the UK.
Thanks, Robbie. Our colleague Olivia wasn't able to join us in preparation for this talk, so we'd just like to thank her for all of her work and contribution to this project. For today's session, we're going to talk about a couple of different kind of converging fields that took place in our research. We're going to talk a bit about corpus linguistics and language pedagogy. We're going to talk about adverbs. We're also going to talk about studies in language change and corpus studies of language change, and thinking about how all of that will come together to help us understand better editorial practices using corpus linguistic research. I'm going to talk to you a little bit now about some of the literature that that has maybe contextualized or helped inform in some way our project. So this project largely fits under the area of indirect applications of corpus linguistics to language teaching and learning, which among a focus on things like learner dictionaries and lexicography, looking at things like assessment and teacher training, our focus is largely on the development of educational materials, namely course books. There are lots of examples of really effective course books that are kind of based on corpus data. For example, the Touchstone series led by Mike McCarthy is a good example, with lots of corpus information, frequency information, different things like that spread throughout the course book and the series. The research on language course books, though, is quite sparse, and we see a couple of different key names emerge, I suppose, when we look at the research on corpus approaches to developing language course books. Graham Burton has done some interesting work on this. Jan McCartan, Mike McCarthy have done some interesting work on this, trying to help us unpack the kind of practices that materials writers kind of engage in when they're developing corpus-informed materials. What does seem to be a little backgrounded in the material in the research to date in this area is the role of the publisher, and I thought that was quite interesting. I think, given my own background, because I used to work in that context, what is it that the publisher is doing that's, you know, a part of this overall process? In earlier research from Burton, they found that the role of the publisher was maybe not necessarily very involved, that they didn't necessarily seem to engage with materials writers for corpus linguistics. And looking at some of Penier's work, the role of corpus linguistics in informing materials writer practices is quite low, because they don't necessarily have the time. And this struck me, because when we think about publishers' engagement with the development of corpora, that's something that's a bit more longer standing. Mike McCarthy's work on kind of encouraging teachers to hold publishers to account to be able to make more use of corpora in their materials development is quite interesting too. And Jan McCartan also has some interesting work looking at how different stakeholders are make use of or are involved in corpus development and corpus use for materials development. But the role of corpora is often backgrounded, or the role of publishers rather, is often backgrounded, and it's not necessarily very clear from the current state of the art what exactly their role is. And while we understand that materials writers might not necessarily have time to engage directly with materials, we wonder whether or not publishers are mitigating this in some way, whether they are kind of involved in any way to help in, you know, make more use of corpora. So what we wanted to do was we wanted to identify how publishers manage use of corpora in their course books, and we also wanted to know what the role of editorial processes were in developing corpus-informed materials, and particularly course books. In terms of a focus, we decided to focus on adverbs in particular, and we did this for a number of reasons. Adverbs are a really important feature of course book lexical grammar, so we can see adverbs kind of regularly occurring in different ways, talking about discourse markers that we use in conversation, or help for particular areas of writing, or adverbs of manner for describing how people are approaching things, etc. And throughout course books, we'll see examples of function and form of adverbs considered, their syntactical placement considered. So again, a lot of variability in the ways in which adverbs are approached. And although they are an integral part of English language course book development, what we also see in the literature is that they're often criticized. Course books are often criticized for not necessarily bringing in kind of a diverse range of adverbs or sufficient complexity surrounding adverb use. And given that adverbs are already a really important area of research for grammarians, for those interested in language change, we thought that adverbs would help us kind of tick all of these boxes in these different areas of study into which we were stepping in this project, and help us better understand the language itself and also how it's being used in the materials that are being developed. So I'm going to hand you over to Robbie now to talk to you through a little bit of information about our data and methods.
Okay, thank you very much, Niall. So moving on to the data and the method, this study takes a longitudinal approach by tracking the journey that corpus research makes from the researcher to the coursebook. So we started by looking at the usage of adverbs in the demographically sampled component of the original spoken BNC from the early 1990s, and we compared this to the new spoken BNC 2014. And so we looked at the overall difference in relative frequency of all tokens that were tagged as adverbs. And then we focused in and conducted five mini case studies on five particular adverb types. And these are like, so, just, well, and literally. And then what we did was report the findings to four participants who held editorial roles at Cambridge University Press. And so we told them what we found with the changes in the usage and the syntactic and functional analysis of the adverbs we did in the case study. And we interviewed them about their reaction to the findings, as well as their overall usage of corpus research in their editorial work. And so the goal of the interviews was to better understand how the publishing teams engage with corpus linguistics in the development of course books. And then, about a year or so later, we looked at the subsequent course books that those editors had published and reviewed the usage of our corpus-informed findings to find out the extent to which they had made it essentially into the published course books. Okay, so the findings. Overall, the use of adverbs is significantly higher in the spoken BNC 2014 compared to its predecessor from the 1990s. So you have 100,000 per million in the new corpus and just under 80,000 per million in the old one. And so there are certain highly frequent adverb types that have increased significantly. And these include adverbs such as like, really, just, so, then, very, how, and right. And then there are adverb types which have decreased significantly, but are still fairly frequent nonetheless. These include on, here, up, out, now, there, and well. And something that was really interesting that we noticed related to adverbs that end in ly, and it seems to be that this suffix is increased in productivity, because not only was the overall frequency of ly adverbs higher in the new corpus, it had raised from 9% to 13% of all adverb usage in the corpus, but actually the individual types, the number of unique types, had also increased as well, which is very interesting. The ly adverb that has increased the most substantially among all, with a log ratio of 3.27, that the effect size, is literally. And that's why we chose it as one of our case study adverbs. So moving on to the case studies, as mentioned, we conducted a syntactic and functional analysis of five adverbs by digging deep into samples, random samples of concordance lines and manually annotating according to their syntax and their function. And we did this using Carter and McCarthy's 2006 grammar as the basis for the categories for the annotation. So starting with like, this has increased significantly between the two corpora. The most sort of common pairing of syntax and function is that of a discourse marker at the clausal level. And so essentially this is the usage of like as a filler. This is very, very common. But another interesting case, which has increased substantially, is the use of like to signal reported speech and thought, so quotative like. This is almost non-existent in the 1990s, and yet yet it is very, very frequent in the 2010s. And it's such a substantial change that it is now the second most common function of like in the 2010s behind the discourse marker. Moving on to so, another adverb that increased. Interestingly, turn initial so has almost doubled in frequency, and it's also increased in usage as a linking adverb. Just has also increased in frequency significantly. And the most common form to function pairing is the modification of verb phrases in terms of manner. So it's a manner adverb. This is more than doubled in frequency. And there are also some interesting differences at the sort of lower end of the frequency of the functions. So, for example, there's a notable drop in the use of just to refer to time. Now, this is really interesting because it seems to be a very useful usage of just, but it is halved in relative frequency between the two corpora. Moving on to well, we decided to include an adverb that had decreased significantly among our case studies as well. It's still the fourth most frequent adverb in the 2010s, but it has decreased significantly. Within that decrease, though, there's a substantial increase of a clause-modifying linking adverbial, and this actually comes in the phrase as well. And so that's a very interesting change, that overall the frequency has gone down, but within that decrease, there's actually an increase of a particular syntactic role. Finally, we return to the case of literally, the most increased ly adverb. Syntactically, the increase seems to coincide with more versatility. It appears in a wider range of positions and does more jobs, essentially. And from a semantic perspective, it seems to be undergoing a process of generalization. If we look at whether it refers to something that is real or metaphorical, it used to be the case that literally mostly referred to things that were literal in the world. But now it's routinely used metaphorically as a marker of emphasis and intensification. And so we took all of these findings and more to the editors at Cambridge University Press. And that's what Niall is going to tell you about now. So back to you, Niall.
So as Robbie said, we had these interesting findings from our corpus study and our case studies of adverbs, and we wanted to try and bring this information to editors in order to try and see how they would make use of this information in their own practices. We worked with four editors at Cambridge University Press on this project, and ideally we would like to expand some of this work into other editorial practices, into other contexts. However, we thought that keeping the scope quite narrow for now, given that there isn't a lot of information about publishers' practices in the current literature on corpus linguistics already, that keeping this narrower scope would help us delimit any kind of skewed variables and work within one kind of cultural context. So looking in this very particular context, we worked with four editors and we wanted to first find out what their engagement with corpora was. And generally, all of them had an idea about what corpus linguistics was and how it would impact on their work. However, of the four editors with whom we'd worked, only two of them had actually used corpora before. That being said, they all felt that corpus linguistics in general, the insights from corpus linguistics were effective for improving and informing their editorial choices, and many of them didn't necessarily do this corpus research themselves, but read other papers or had others who could conduct this kind of corpus research for them. And so in general, we're engaging with corpus research in some shape or form. And when we presented the findings of our research to the editors, it was quite an interesting engagement then. We found that the editors were quite surprised by the significant changes over time, and particularly with things like literally and the changes in metaphorical use of literally. The editors kind of speculated then about the ways in which they could use these kind of insights. The two editors talked about using these changes in adverbs to help support the writing of dialogues and scripts, or for videos and for listening recordings. And the remaining editors talked about things like using the adverb so or using the adverb well to be able to signal different register features and maybe kind of call out boxes to be able to kind of point to how these are being used in things like casual conversation. with a focus on conversation skills development and spoken language development. Two of the editors identified that the changes would be useful for the development of materials that focus on specifically on teaching speaking skills, given that we were looking at British casual spoken conversation. And while they do enjoy having this information about the ways in which language is changing, they didn't necessarily think that the frequency information was something that would be of interest to teachers and students. So they looked for ways to kind of work around that. A year later then, after we conducted these interviews, we engaged with the same editors and we asked them if they could send us back examples of their materials and how they've used these materials, or these corpus insights in their materials. And we found some really interesting things. For example, in the coursebook Talent, the level 3 coursebook Talent, what we found was in one of the supplementary videos, there was a little extract that I talked about like. And you can see it here on the screen, effectively it says, so that's all clear, but something very interesting has happened with the word like over the past 10 years. Corpus data shows us that the word like is used much more frequently today than it was 15 years ago, but in a very different way. So they're actually bringing in the corpus data, even though they initially said that they might not talk about frequency. They're bringing in the corpus data to be able to talk about like as a filler in this particular video. In another course book, we can see the insights being used in the development of little tip boxes. And you can see this pop up on the screen here. You can use literally to exaggerate a description. I literally froze. So this was their attempt at bringing in some of this metaphorical information into the data. And so there, for example, we can kind of see how the information that we've presented to them went full circle and has made its way onto the page in the student's book. And of course, there are lots of other examples here, but for a time, we can't really talk about them all. But I think these will give you some illustrative ideas of where this corpus research has gone. I think overall, the conclusions that we can draw from this research is that studying the kind of the language change in adverbs offered us useful perspectives in being able to understand how contemporary spoken British English and adverb use has changed over a 20-year period. And I think the results of the study in those 5 case studies is interesting in and of itself. But the kind of second part of this study then, looking at the utility of corpora for large-scale materials development in publishing context, throughout the study we're able to see that editorial roles are in fact quite impactful, at least in this context, in the development of educational materials using corpora. The editors did raise some interesting questions about the future of corpus linguistics for materials development, and in a context wherein corpora or rather educational materials are more and more concerned with English as a lingua franca and international approaches to the use of English, issues surrounding the construction of corpora and the representative nature of corpora might be making it more difficult for them to engage with them. For example, while this study was based on British national corpus, the evidence that we talked about then was looking at British English. Therefore, if there were course books that were trying to have a more international kind of approach to dealing with English, or perhaps wanting to work with other varieties like American English, they weren't necessarily as relevant. And that was a consideration that they raised in the interviews. So one thing that we identified in this study looking forward is that there are a couple of important questions emerging regarding the composition of corpora for informing future educational materials, and how we'll be able to produce corpora that will address the needs of education in international contexts. So thank you all very much for taking some time to listen to our talk. I hope that you found it interesting, and it would be great to hear from you and answer any questions that you may have. Myself and Robbie will be there with you.